patients left to starve and rot on their beds at Afghanistan's main military hospital, despite funding and oversight by the US. Why did it take so long for these conditions to be uncovered? You're watching Inside Story Americas from Washington. Hello, I'm Shihab Ratansi. Some of the images are so gruesome we've decided not to broadcast them. Emaciated Afghan patients neglected in their hospital beds with open sores, maggots on their wounds, some left to die. These were the conditions in Afghanistan's Dawood Khan National Military Hospital, finally uncovered by a few members of the US military in 2010. The hospital is run by the Afghan government, but it's mainly funded by the United States. Its doctors and nurses are also being trained and overseen by the United States and NATO. One US colonel involved in the investigation described what he saw there as Auschwitz-like. However, several military officers told a congressional hearing last week that attempts to launch an investigation were prevented by General William Caldwell. He was one of the highest-ranking commanders in Afghanistan. They allege he was concerned about political repercussions ahead of the 2010 congressional elections and the effect on his own career. Here is some of last week's congressional testimony on conditions at Afghanistan's Dawood Military Hospital.
The open vats of blood draining out of soldiers' wounds, the feces on the floor. The other thing that caught my attention was there were many family members taking care of their loved ones, not hospital staff, but family members. And this was obviously surprising to me to see a hospital where family members were actually emptying these vats of blood and other receptacles used to help the patients out, because they lack personnel in the hospital to do their jobs. So again, you had a very abusive and corrosive anti-hospital in the Western world situation that was ongoing and getting worse. And that doesn't even go into the images that were previously portrayed on the TV of the human suffering.
So what went so wrong at the Dawood Military Hospital? And what does the subsequent alleged cover-up tell us about transparency in the US military? To discuss this, we're joined by the former command surgeon off the NATO training mission in Afghanistan, retired Air Force Colonel Skylar Geller. He began the internal investigation into the hospital. From Kabul, we have Wall Street Journal reporter Maria Abi-Habib, who first broke the story about conditions at Dawood leading to the congressional investigation. And we're also joined by Gareth Porter, veteran investigative journalist on national security. And before we start, we just want to warn our viewers that some of the images that we'll be playing throughout this program are pretty disturbing. So there are two parts to this story then, Colonel Geller. The appalling situation at the hospital and then the subsequent attempts to cover the situation up. So let's begin with the hospital itself. The US gets involved with Dawood in 2005. It's a recipient of millions of dollars. You arrive in 2010. When do you realize all is not well?
Shortly after I arrived, I was informed that there was problems with executing the budget, and I was informed by the program's commander at NTMA. I realized that money was questionably being utilized, and so I began reviewing our contracts. As we looked at that, there were continuing requests for supplies, materials, equipment that it appeared had been previously purchased and purchased in an adequate amount.
So this is the corruption side of the problems at Dawood. And I should add, NTMA, NATO Training Mission in Afghanistan.
Yes, right. Yes. With my visits to the hospital, I saw nothing amiss with patient care initially, as had no senior medical advisor because we get the dog and pony show, the wet mop tour, if you will, so that it was not until after I had discovered how significant the problems were in the medical logistics piece, the support and supply to patients, the failure of patients to get medicines, and then as we moved into later in the summer, a couple of new physicians came on board for the NATO training mission, Afghanistan's medical training advisory group, and they came to the wards, and with another nurse, Stacy Atchison, these two physicians were Captain Rich Black and Steve Mitchell, Lieutenant Colonel Mitchell. They began bringing these patient reports forward.
So up to this point, though, there hadn't actually been unannounced ward visits or any real visits other than in the heavily choreographed official tours.
Exactly.
So what did you see? And when did you finally see it? And what did you see?
It ends in late September. I was the recipient of multiple reports from the staff of the medical embedded training team at the National Military Hospital of egregious professional misconduct, neglect, abuse, and failure to treat that led to patients' deaths. These specific cases I was brought to see these individual patients. And this was the beginning of the result, seeing the results of a long history of a culture of impunity at the National Military Hospital.
Maria Abi-Habib, then, as Colonel Geller is beginning to get the full picture of how of the terrors, of the horrors of Dawood National Military Hospital, there is this twin track that you're on the outside. You're a reporter at Kabul, and you're beginning to hear, or you're hearing stories about Kabul, about this hospital. When how did that process begin leading up to your Wall Street Journal story of September 2011?
Well, it took me about 8 months to finally break the story and reach the people I needed to. I'd heard a whiff about it from somebody quite senior at ISAF, and he was leaving in the winter time frame of 2011 and was quite disgusted with the way that the hospital situation just hadn't really been resolved, and mentioned it to me. And I kept just trying to find anybody who would speak to me about this. And actually it was Afghans who put me in touch with Dr. Geller. Afghans who were also just disgusted with the corruption, Afghans who worked at the military hospital. And I showed up to the military hospital and they said, this is Dr. Geller's number, you need to speak to him. And we probably did about 15 hours of interviews and we spent a lot of time together. And he showed me lots of gruesome images.
As Colonel Geller was saying, though, and this was on the PR circuit, you've written about General Caldwell, who we mentioned earlier, actually pinning a medal at one point on the body of an emaciated soldier. Tell us more about that.
Well, General Caldwell, when I spoke to him, said that he'd noticed that there was something wrong with the emaciated patient, but couldn't quite tell me why nothing really happened with his with the patient's, it just seemed like General Caldwell was very vague, so he kind of said that he had seen the emaciated patient, but kind of left it up in the air as to what he then did about the emaciated patient.
Colonel Geller, how did it get to this situation? Why had previous NATO personnel, previous U.S. officers who were overseeing the hospital not said anything about this, or not even tried to even investigate what they were actually supposed to be overseeing?
I believe that the most senior of the...
Maria, we'll come to you in a second.
The most senior never got to see the reality. They were always given the general's tour of the hospital. And so it was the presentation of what are the positive things that the medical embedded training team have done, which was the message that was generally delivered.
But beyond the superiors there, what about the actual people who are overseeing and training the medical personnel there? Surely they must be seeing this on a daily basis.
As I talked to about the hospital, it's a 400-bed hospital. It is associated with the Academy of Medical Science, which is the true training mission with classes of combat medics, nurses, and technicians. A third of our staff was working in the training mission. About two-thirds of the staff was in the hospital assisting with the medical support mission, training individual administrators, physicians, and nurses. But that number was very small in the 15, 16.
It doesn't take
range.
Many people to see how appalling the conditions are, though. So what, you know, again, why didn't they raise the alarm sooner, perhaps? Well, Maria, yes.
Let me cut in here for 1 minute, because from the numerous people that I spoke to for this story. There was one mentor who had actually come back last year who I spoke to, and he'd actually been mentoring back in 2006, and he said that the conditions were the exact same in 2006. Patients starving to death, patients dying of very simple wounds. And remember, a lot of these people are Afghan war heroes who have fought the Taliban on the US dime. And he said that it was the same thing. They just bring it up the chain. Maybe not as forcefully as Dr. Galler, but yeah, they brought it up the chain. But the problem is that this is a fundamental problem we see in the U.S. military in Afghanistan, is that most troops are deployed for 1 year. So by the time that they actually can grasp the fact that there's a problem, it's time to get out and go back home. And then they maybe send that information to their whoever fills their place, but again, it's just such a complex war that it takes a while to figure out and really get a hold of what's happening. So, and also to figure out, to really take on the hospital, it really takes on the way that the U.S. military strategy is conducted here. I mean, it's a complete overhaul that would need to be done at the hospital, as we're seeing now. And that's not good news for people who are in a position of seniority in the military and want to rise up through the ranks, or have a very precise mission that they need to fulfill, because that just doesn't, that won't help them get to where they need to be to figure out those targets of success.
Colonel Geller, I mean, was that the sense that it was just simply a matter of new people coming in every few months or every year, I suppose, and being told, well, look, this is just third world medicine, you know, there's nothing wrong here.
There is no measuring rod for them. They come from first world medicine. They've trained in U.S. hospitals. They don't know what third world medicine ought to look
but
like.
But maggots and open sores and starving to death and I mean,
I... And even that might not register as it ought to if you were certainly in a first world. This is absolute negligence and
or perhaps it's more to do with the wartime.
But it's a combat zone,
right.
and it's a totally different environment, and they have no preparation. There's no training preparation for them.
Gareth, we were told then that there was this new strategy of counterinsurgency. A great deal of that, according to the handbook, then, is about hearts and minds and getting people to believe in what's happening, of building institutions, especially institutions when it comes to those that treat the Afghan military, one would think, because you're trying to get people to get involved with the Afghan military. If they believe in this COIN strategy, this counterinsurgency strategy, why then would generals be so uninterested in the squalid circumstances of Dawood Hospital?
Look, I think we're dealing here with both a system of military bureaucracy and carrying out a major counterinsurgency war in a country like Afghanistan, which is extremely poor and into which the United States pours billions of dollars every few months, really. And at the same time, a set of values, a problem of values, essentially. Because On one hand, look, we have the reality that everybody knows that the Afghan army and Ministry of Defense are corrupt and are siphoning off large amounts of money. And of course, at the same time, it's turned out that the medicine was being shipped to Pakistan, where it fetched a better price to line the pockets of high-level bureaucrats with the Ministry of Defense. At the same time, they could see these patients were malnourished, as was reported by Maria in her story as early as 2006. It doesn't take a genius to put those together. And I think what we're looking at here is the inherent resistance of the system from the top down to telling the truth. And that's why, of course, what Colonel Geller and his colleagues are doing is so unusual. I mean, this is truth-telling in a situation where truth-telling is not rewarded but punished.
Well, we'll get to the cover-up in a moment, or the alleged cover-up, but to tie that into the rest of the U.S. mission in Afghanistan, the Special Inspector General for Afghan Reconstruction did release a report just this Monday. And that report says, quote, a significant portion of the $400 million the U.S. has invested in infrastructure projects has been wasted because of poor planning. One example, inspectors found problems and delays in the construction of four bases along the border with Pakistan. The report details poor construction, lack of water, leaking generator fuel lines, improperly installed ventilation systems at the bases. The report said the failure by U.S. officials to secure post-U.S. withdrawal funding could jeopardize efforts to stabilize the country. Well, that's another story. But the issue here is that the entire mission is run like this. And what's also interesting, Colonel Geller, is when questioned about conditions at Dawood Hospital, the corruption, the neglect, it appears that Caldwell suggested, well, look, this is part of the counterinsurgency strategy. It's our Afghan self-sufficiency. We don't want to interfere with them as they build their institutions. It might ruin their confidence, I suppose. I mean, what was that argument about then?
Well, everything that we're doing in Afghanistan is supposed to create a sustainable, transitionable organization. In the case of Daoud Khan Hospital and the Afghan Military Academy or Academy of Medical Sciences, that's supposed to create an institution that the Afghans then can run and operate
on. So you
on
can't
their
tell
own.
Them that they're in inhumane conditions and that they're squandering money and they're utterly corrupt and this won't do and you might pull the money? Or I mean,
the only way to make change is to either pull mentors or pull money. What the problem is that I would take a little bit of exception in just saying Ministry of Defense is corrupt and Army is corrupt. There are criminal patronage networks that have captured institutions within Afghanistan. And in my visual, my arc, the Daoud Khan Hospital was one of those. And it is the culture of impunity that is the protection of those patronage networks that allows the Afghan doctors and nurses not to do their job.
All right, so let's get onto this issue of what was done once this information was brought to the attention of William Caldwell. This is how U.S. Army Colonel Mark Fassi described Caldwell's response. Mark Fassel, this is how he described Caldwell's response.
His first response to me was, how could we do this or make this request? With elections coming, and then he made the really, again, shocking comment that he calls me Bill.
What does that mean?
Well, I took it as that he was referring to the President of the United States.
So, Colonel Geller, just to clarify what was said there. So, Caldwell says we can't make a fuss about this because the midterm elections then in 2010 were approaching. And that comment about he calls me Bill appears to be Caldwell suggesting that he's on diminutive first name terms with the President of the United States.
General Caldwell told us that he had regular video conferences with the President of the United States related to the NATO training mission in Afghanistan and the funding, the CSTICA, Combined Security Transition Command funding. So I know he had regular conversations, or he reported that he had regular conversations to us, the Colonel Mentor group. I was not part of that conversation that Mark had with Lieutenant General Colville, but I was in the meeting with Jerry Carroza and Major General, well, then Brigadier General Patton, who said to us, we want to really postpone any request from the DIG until after the
Inspector General of the Department of Defense.
Thank you. Yes, the Department of Defense Inspector General investigation. And oh, by the way, we don't want an investigation. We just want an assistance visit, which is entirely different personnel and demeanor of the arrival of that team. But he said, we want to wait until after the election before we do it. And he said specifically, Lieutenant General Caldwell wants us to wait until after the election.
What are you told to do with the evidence that you've been collecting up to that point then on the abuses at Dawood?
At that point, my team, the Medical Training Advisory Group, has been providing daily reports, pictures, case histories, and providing that to the Assistant Commanding General for Army Development, Canadian Brigadier David Neesmith, who was the conduit to Deputy Commander Army General Patton and then to Lieutenant General Caldwell.
But then you're told to basically deep six them once this turns into just a mission to help them improve their logistics, right?
The data was not destroyed or asked to be destroyed until later. That occurred in 2011.
Well, that is interesting, because eventually there is an Inspector General investigation.
Well, not an investigation, a staff assistance visit.
And these are very important distinctions.
This is a different term.
And so there is finally a central database, though, of evidence.
Yes, we put all of this data, all the pictures, all the emails, all the spreadsheets, all the PowerPoint and the Word documents into a SharePoint website that had both an unclassified and a classified section. And this was available to the Department of Defense Inspector General team on their arrival.
What happens to that SharePoint database?
It's destroyed.
Do we know how it's destroyed?
No. It suddenly does not exist.
You know, what strikes me is that it may well be.
Basically.
Maria, yes, do go on.
Sorry. Go ahead.
I mean, his hard drives were wiped clean, and that's what happened.
Gareth.
And there's no explanation.
It strikes me that it may well be that...
You have to realize that also that for when you brought up the whole comment about he calls me Bill, you have to realize that when you're at that level in the military, if you're going to get a fourth star, the U.S. president has to approve it.
Yeah. Actually, does it look like he's going to get that fourth star now?
Which, who knows?
Probably not. But, you know, I think that it may well be that he had reason to believe that the president would have preferred not to have this happen.
But how influential is William Caldwell? Is he simply, is it really about the midterm elections? Is it about it doesn't really matter which political party he's serving. It's simply about not being the bearer of bad news.
No, right. I mean, both the White House and General Petraeus and General Caldwell all share an interest in maintaining the good news about success in Afghanistan. They don't want a major story cropping up that disturbs this narrative. And I think that's really the fundamental political problem that, you know, Colonel Geller and others who were trying to get the truth out faced.
And what's interesting, though, is that this is now actually being presented as a good news story by General Petraeus.
Because
abuses were found.
He had the temerity to claim that, you know, what actually happened in this hospital shows that the United States is successful in combating corruption in the Afghan military and government, which, of course, is an outrageous lie. I mean, you know, the fact is that the United States has not been successful in combating corruption in Afghanistan at all. It's dipped out a few cupfuls of water in a great sea.
All right, we've still got a great deal more to discuss. So what we're going to do is we'll continue this discussion in our online version, but that's it for our broadcast edition of Inside Story. Maria Abi-Habib in Kabul, thank you very much. Colonel Skylar Geller, thank you. Gareth Porter, thank you. But we'll have more online. All right, let's continue this discussion now. Gareth Porter, I mean, it's an amazing succession of information that we've just had. How does this fit in with the prevailing media management philosophy of the U.S. military right now?
Well, I mean, it's very important to understand that it was, in fact, David Petraeus who essentially advanced the notion of how you use the news media to shape a narrative for a counterinsurgency war when he was out of Iraq, before he went to Iraq, for his command of all U.S. forces there, to write a counterinsurgency manual. In that manual, he has a very fascinating approach to the role that he says the commander must play or should play in a counterinsurgency war, to use the news media to shape the narrative so that it supports the war effort. Now, this is, of course, probably what other commanders have wanted to do, but he put it, he codified that in that counterinsurgency manual and then went to Iraq and very deliberately, you know, used that approach to help shape what the news media would cover about the war in Iraq, and essentially, you know, turned what had been a losing battle into a great victory.
Well, it's interesting because we had Lieutenant Colonel Daniel Davis, who published a report in January, which claimed that U.S. generals in Afghanistan were giving rosy estimates of the situation when the opposite was true, in fact. This is the first line of that report. Senior-ranking U.S. military leaders have so distorted the truth when communicating with the U.S. Congress and American people in regards to conditions on the ground in Afghanistan that the truth has become unrecognizable. This deception has damaged America's credibility among both our allies and enemies, severely limiting our ability to reach a political solution to the war in Afghanistan. Colonel Geller, does that chime with yours?
I saw only significant good news stories being promoted, and people who provided those good news stories were getting all the attaboys and the attention. Bad news stories were the Afghans have to deal with that. That's an Afghan problem. Work on the areas that you're being successful in, and tell the success stories. At the year in review, the end story of the first year of the NATO training mission in Afghanistan. The email that went out to us was, we want your three greatest successes of the last year. And then an example of that was sent to us.
What about, even if not for public consumption then, what about at least for logistic and strategic consumption, even within the DoD? Is there much appetite for hearing what the conditions are really like then? And is there room for whistleblowers to tell people what the situation is like, even within the Pentagon? No.
Whistleblowers never have a particularly good time. However, there are some commanders who are better at receiving the bad news stories. Most of the commanders, however, have not been. My commander, the assistant commanding general for Army Development, Brigadier David Neesmith, was the example of what the finest infantryman should look like. And he took the good news and the bad news and he sifted it.
All right, well, there's some good news there. Maria,
he wasn't allowed to speak to the press, of course. That's part of
the Maria abi-habib, I mean, that is the point. How do you do your job? I mean, clearly there's corruption and incompetence and brutality on all sides in this war. We get these glimpses every now and then, but do we have a clear picture of what's going on in Afghanistan right now?
No, we don't, and we won't. You know, the most concerning thing I'd say is the fact that once Afghanistan dies off of, not dies, but once Afghanistan news isn't as interesting for international audiences, and a lot of international bureaus like mine whittle down their numbers or maybe just rely on Afghan journalists, the intimidation of Afghan journalists is going to rise from the Afghan government as well. I mean, after I put out that hospital story, it's cut.
Oh, that's a shame. Well, we'll carry on. Actually, but I think if we can reestablish that contact with Maria in Kabul and talk, because that is an interesting question, Colonel Geller, this issue of safety. Once you do blow the whistle, do you feel safe, especially in a war zone like Afghanistan?
When Rear Admiral Beck, the PAO, refused to allow me to speak on the record to Maria Habib. He told me if I chose to go on the record to her, I was, quote, on my own, unquote. It's a dangerous place to be on your own.
Mm. I mean, what are they threatening there? What do you, I mean?
It's just the words, and you'll take it as a warning or not.
Still, though, I mean, we have several investigations underway, apparently, formal DOD. Well, actually, give me the right terms. I mean, they may not be investigations. They're staff assessments, are they? I'm not entirely sure now sometimes as to what's an investigation and what isn't. But these the investigations that are being conducted are more, again, into the handling of the information, the whistleblowing process, but still not actually about the conditions at Dawood Hospital and how they're allowed to deteriorate to such an extent, as far as I can tell.
The staff assistance visit that had its formal report the 14th of June 2011 had a follow-up report in May of 2012. It is still only being directed at the procurement and distribution of pharmaceuticals and supplies and
The corruption involved there.
And the corruption that is continuing to be involved there. The process remains non-transparent, and therefore, even after a year and a half later, the report documents that the criminal patronage networks remain in control of the contracting process.
And look, I mean, the bottom line about this story is that Maria published this almost a year ago. And what has happened in terms of transparency, in terms of accountability? Really nothing. The US Congress basically has refused to do anything about it, even though they were given this information months ago. And the news media has not followed up. This has not become a major story. It is not part of the political discourse in this country. The system has worked systematically, as it always does, to essentially prevent this from disrupting the good news about U.S. effort in Afghanistan.
And Maria, I believe you're back now online with us. I mean, you were making that point about the atmosphere in which it's possible to reveal what's actually going on in Afghanistan and how it's not terribly good.
Mm-hmm. Well, yes, and I'd also like to kind of speak to one point that was mentioned just 30 seconds ago, which is just that, you know, the U.S. can't its hands are tied in this. I mean, they are partnered with a government that really tolerates a large level of corruption, and they have no other players that they could bring into government. So if they're going to go and start doing these investigations quite seriously with the idea of prosecution, then either the majority of the Afghan government would be behind bars, or basically all funding would stop here, which would be complete military failure because the Afghan government would implode within if they didn't have U.S. Funds. On the point when it comes to reporting here, I mean, it's what is really, really concerning is the fact that, you know, once the NATO troops leave, the majority of them leave in 2014, interest in the Afghan story will die down. And a lot of us, like our bureau, hope to leave an Afghan journalist here to help cover, you know, drive our reporting. But the intimidation of Afghan journalists is going to be quite severe. Once I put out that hospital article, the Minister of Defense spokesperson, General Azimi, called me a spy on TV. There was another story that I did about the Air Force, the Afghan Air Force, running drugs and weapons, and they put out a statement, very detailed statement, pretty much with all my details, except for where I live and what my hair color is, saying that I was a spy and that I take money from foreign governments. So if they feel comfortable doing this with a US journalist, then imagine how difficult the situation is going to be here for Afghan journalists. And a lot of Afghan journalists just tell me that they can't touch a lot of my stories. They'd like to follow up on them, and I would like to see them follow up on them. It's their country. But they're just intimidated by the government. What's very worrying is that in the investigation that the Afghan government has partly somewhat started on the hospital, two or three key Afghan witnesses got knocks on their door, and luckily their family members answered, And there are men with AK-47s saying, where is so-and-so? We hear he's testifying soon. There's no witness protection program here. So justice really can't be served in a lot of these cases because there's just the whole system works against a proper judicial process happening.
That's exactly the case.
It's very distressing. Yeah.
Maria's right that there are really only
two
choices.
Very distressing that Afghan journalists can't.
Gareth Porter, last thought.
The reality is that you have only two choices. One is really to pull out of continuing this assistance to this government, which is an evil system, and end this war. You can't have it both ways. You can't do the right thing and continue this war effort. And I think that's really the bottom line about this whole story, that you don't have a choice except to see this as a sign that it's really necessary to get out.
Gareth Porter, thank you very much. Colonel Skylar Gallup, thank you. Maria Abi-Habib in Kabul, thank you so much too. And that's it from Inside Story, America's from Washington.